sir?
Good.
Mr. Pan?
Hi, how are you?
Good.
I'm good, I need to worry about it.
Yeah? You, I thought I said that. How are you, Lawanda?
I'm good, thank you.
I tried to call you a while ago, you didn't answer me, so I wasn't asking.
Oh, okay.
Do you have any talk on that? Third revival?
I don't know, very rooted.
Very rooted. He said if I need a call, I guess. Give me that.
And that's what they tell you to do.
How's everybody this evening?
Good.
A great Monday. I can rest just a minute.
It's good.
How you doing?
I like that red tie.
Thank you. Supposed to be powerful, right? Ha ha ha. It's for the bull, you know.
What we get?
You know that clock slows down when it gets to about 3 minutes till, but.
I don't catch up to you.
Maybe I was going.
Thank you, Fred. Father, we thank thank you right now for this hour. We thank you for this opportunity. We bless your name and come recognizing you now, Father, head the owner, the head of this universe. We pray right now, Father, that we'd be able to make decisions pleasing and right. We thank you right now for your perseverance that we be able to do the things that are right. We pray right now, Father, for this community. We pray for this country. We pray for those in leadership right now. Father, we also pray for those that's standing around the world that's protecting us. And we thank you for them. We thank you that you bless their families. Is there a way from their families doing good things? And we bless them. Then we pray for the home front. Father, we pray that all will be able to get along, do what's right. Help us, Father, as we go to try to do this kind of business. We thank you for all of these in Taylor County, especially those that's on the front line here. The employees, we ask for your protection again. Father, then we ask for protection for us and our families as we go to do the various jobs and various thoughts. Let us be mindful that we are here to serve and we are not bosses. Let us be mindful that it's you and it's not us. Let us be mindful right now, Father, that there's a getting up morning one day, and we all need to be on board. We thank you now again, and we bless you. We love you. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, liberty and justice for all.
Before we get started our meeting, we always read this, and I think it's a good thing. In an effort to protect the public and the Board of County Commissioners, the conference line has been set up to 1-0-2-2. The access code is 32347 pound sign. This is not a toll-free number, and you may be subject to long-distance charges according to your long-distance plan. When the chairperson opens the meeting for public comment, please follow the below instructions. Please dial 5. The moderator will unmute your line when it's your turn to speak and notify you by announcing the last 4 digits of your telephone number. Please announce your name and address. You will be allowed to speak for 3 minutes. This meeting will also be live streamed on the Taylor County Board of County Commissioners Facebook page. You must have a Facebook profile. Search under the Taylor County Board of County Commissioners and you can view the meeting at 6 p.m. The Facebook live stream will not be monitored for questions or comments. Please call the conference call number if you wish to speak. I think that gets that. And we will go into our business tonight. First thing on our business, approval of the agenda.
Motion to approve.
Second.
Motion second. Yeah, all in favor? Okay. So we'll go to consent agendas. Is there anything of, award recognition? The board to consider adoption of proclamation designation May the 16th to 22nd, 2021 as emergency service. Requested by Scott Pendarvey, operation manager for Century Endowment.
Make a motion that we read the proclamation in its entirety.
Okay. Mr. Bishop. Mr. Scott Pendarvey.
Yes, sir. We got a second.
I got a motion and a second. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
EMS Week proclamation to designate the week of May 16th to the 22nd, 2021 as Emergency Medical Service Week. Whereas emergency medical services is a vital public service, and whereas the members of emergency medical service teams are ready to provide life-saving care to those in need 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And whereas access to quality emergency care dramatically improves the survival and recovery rate of those who experience sudden illness or injury, and whereas emergency medical services have grown to fill a gap by providing important out-of-hospital care, including preventive medicine, follow-up care, and access to telemedicine, and whereas the emergency medical services system consists of first responders, emergency medical technicians, paramedics, emergency medical dispatchers, firefighters, police officers, educators, administrators, pre-hospital nurses, emergency physicians, trained members of the public, and other out-of-hospital medical care providers. And whereas the members of emergency medical services teams, whether career or volunteer, engage in thousands of hours of specialized training and continuing education to enhance their life-saving skills. And where it is appropriate to recognize the value and the competence of emergency medical service providers by designating Emergency Medical Service Week. Now, therefore, we proclaim that the Taylor County Board of County Commissioners, in recognition of this event, do hereby proclaim the week of May 16th through the 22nd, 2021, as Emergency Medical Services Week, with the EMS strong theme, "This is EMS, cared for our communities." I encourage the community to observe this week with appropriate programs, ceremonies, and activities. Done in order this third day of May 2021 in Taylor County, Florida.
Thank you. Did we hear from him now? And we didn't hear. Okay. Ben Dawson.
Well, thank y'all for approving this. I brought along with the flyer. I'll pass this around to y'all. This is the flyer for our opening house of our new station. If y'all have not seen the new station, it's over on 301 East Hampton. So this is our planned event for that week.
I get one.
Yes, you sure do.
Thanks, sir.
Yes, it is mainly for the stakeholders and stuff like that, but we are going to put it in the paper here in the next week or so. That was the first. I just got the flyer done last week, so I haven't had a chance to send it over to the paper, but yes, it will go out into the paper. We'll have a small little ceremony. We'll be recognizing some employees, some of the outstanding jobs they have done in the past few months. We'll be recognizing them. We'll be recognizing our partners that has helped us out in this journey. You guys, as well as county manager's office, as well as the hospital and Chance Care, and all the little different ins and outs that we'll be recognizing in that little ceremony. So appreciate y'all coming out. I appreciate y'all recognizing this. That's really all I have. I do want to let you guys know. I do know that we owe you some data. Here, we are past the first 120 days. Here in the next few weeks, I'll be getting with Ms. LaWanda to set up the EMS advisory meeting. It'll be at our office there. I have a conference room there that we can get whoever needs to come out and sit in that presentation, and we'll go through the data and present what we have. So, y'all have anything for me?
I'm just hearing really good stuff about y'all. So, I'm really looking forward to hearing what you have to say about everything. And
yes.
Hope that the community has accepted y'all very well.
So far as from my understanding, they have.
Yes, that's what I hear too.
We always have the ones a few, but that's the only time you do anything.
That's exactly right.
But from what I can tell, the majority is happy. And our goal is to provide high quality care to the citizens of this county. That's my primary goal.
And we're real pleased to have you. Thank you.
You're
with that said, Mr. Chair, go ahead, then I'll make a motion.
You sing too?
I'm sorry?
You sing?
I sing?
Yeah. Sing? Yeah, do you sing?
Yeah, I sing.
Are you related to the famous Mr. Tracy Pendar?
I was told I wasn't. There's so many few Pendo Arvises, I have a hard time believing that. But I was told I wasn't.
Okay, we're glad to have you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Okay.
You have a motion?
I'll make a motion that we approve the proclamation.
I'll second.
Second, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, you got it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We go to consent agenda. Do I have a motion?
Second.
Motion second, we approve consent agenda. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Number 13, we go to bids and public hearing. Board to receive bids for construction of a gas plant road widening resurfacing project. Set for this date at 6 p.m. or soon thereafter as possible.
Mr. Chairman, the bid committee will be myself, the Public Works Director Hank Evans, and the road superintendent Scott Knight.
Okay.
We had two bids that were received. So the first one is from Kirk's Construction from Washington, Florida.
The total lump sum bid price is $1,242,221.29. And the second bid is from Anderson Columbia from Lake City, Florida. Columbia's total lump sum bid price is $874,906.18.
900 what?
$874,906.18.
Part of the difference is it's a asphalt intensive project, and so you would expect a supplier or a contractor that has the resources of an asphalt company and does self-performing on that part of it to have some pricing advantage. That's what you're seeing in the difference there.
And that's you?
That's me, myself, the Public Works Director, Hank Evans, and Scott Knight, the road superintendent. Given the difference in the pricing between it and what funds we have available under the DOT allocation, I will forward these bids to them, ask for their consideration, request some additional funding, and then we'll see where it goes from there.
How short are we?
The original project itself was only funded $700,000. The designers, this was one of our recent continuing contract designers, George and Hutchins. They did a pretty good job on bare bonesing what they were doing. I think it was over $400,000 in just asphalt alone. So it's hard to get to that level that DOT had priced it at in order to make it cost effective. We have options, of course. We kept it at an 11-foot lane because the traffic volumes were low through there. There's not a lot of value engineering that we can shave off of it, so hopefully DOT will look at that and creative and what funding they can come up with, but if they don't, and the county administrator and I can't resolve it, you know, we'll come back to you guys for some additional consideration.
I was telling some people today about this road resurfacing, that you've been very successful so far at getting that additional funding when we needed it. I want to tell you, we really appreciate what you do.
Yeah, they, like I've said before, Santa Pier, they like us. We are one of the top counties in the District 2 zone as far as project completion and funding, and that's because we ask. You know, the only way you're going to get it is if you ask. And so they know the quality of projects that we deliver. We try to mimic their qualities and their standards, and it goes a long ways towards them having the ability to easily fund things. So we'll try. You know, you all know very well things are tight at the government level or at the state level. So, you know, it's getting harder to be successful, but obviously we'll give it our best effort.
Speaking of quality roads, I've heard, had quite a few compliments on the Hingston Cannon Road. Even from people on East Ellison Road, they talked about what a nice road that is.
That did, it turned out.
It's very nice. I mean, I'm very pleased with it. I think everybody else is too.
Yes, ma'am. You'll see, and you know, you give it a couple of years to mature, and that'll be a very scene improvement.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah, is this Kirk Construction ever done a road in Perry before?
As a matter of fact, Kirk's Construction constructed Hingston Tanner Road.
Okay.
They were the contractor for that project.
Is that the only one you had?
It is. Well, I got two more later, but I'm not going to stand here for that one.
So we're going to bring it back to us when?
I don't know. I'll get our copies from the clerk tomorrow, but I'll type up this. I'll post the results on our webpage tomorrow. I'll send the correspondence to the District 2 coordinators, and then I'll go to Begging. They're going to call me tomorrow on the First Avenue project around 11, so I will go ahead and enlighten them that, you know, that it's coming, that we're going to come with our hat in our hand and a lot of hope. We'll see.
Okay. Who's that District 2 coordinator from us?
Kim Evans is the our main funding lady. Dave Serlinak is one who does all the program, the design review, so he's one who physically looks at our plans. And then Amy Robertson, she's another one over there that has a lot of input, as well as the local agency programs, the sidewalk jobs.
That's in Lake City?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Do we need a motion on that?
No, I'm not making a recommendation.
Okay. All right. All right. We go to number 14, public request, Margaret. Is that Richard?
Richard, I believe.
So it's Town of Fast.
Good afternoon, Commissioners.
Hi.
My name is Margaret Reader. I am the Northeast Florida Regional Manager for Chief Financial Officer Jimmy Petronas. I'd like to first of all introduce myself and offer myself as a resource to you and all citizens of Taylor County. I serve as a liaison between your county and Tallahassee. Throughout my territory, I facilitate community outreach, I share the information and resources that my office offers, and I aid with any local issues you guys have that you need help from my office and state government. Since hurricane season is coming up, we do advocate for financial preparedness as well as physical preparedness. Everyone knows to stock up on water, batteries, that sort of thing. We also have a financial emergency preparedness toolkit that you can download online from our website. That's myfloridacfo.com. I know that everyone has a digital way to access their bank account, insurance, and all those things. However, when a storm hits, one of the first things you lose is power, and service is also very inconsistent. So it's very helpful to have a physical copy of all of your information, your insurance information, all of your mortgage, your bank account, everything like that. We absolutely advocate to have that prepared and ready to go in the event of a storm where you're not able to access those online resources that you normally have and don't really think about not having access to. In addition to that, under the Department of Financial Services, We are over insurance regulation, which means that after a storm passes, if you have damage, we have resources through the state to help people through the insurance process. That includes helping people file claims. That includes if you have a complaint about an insurance company, we are who you file with. If you notice insurance fraud, we are also the departments to handle that. This is also if you were denied a claim that you think was wrongly denied. If you're thinking of seeking legal counsel, we highly recommend you contact our office first. There are things that we can do to step in and try something else with the insurance companies. Once you reach out to your lawyer, our hands are tied, we can't touch it. So those are just a few things that we are able to advocate for. I wanted to share a few websites and phone numbers to help everyone. All this information is on myfloridacfo.com. It's going to be all the general information and the insurance. We also have preparefl.com for a storm preparation site. Phone numbers are 1-877-MY-FL-CFO, which is 693-5236, which is the general hotline for our office and also covers insurance. We also have the Florida Department of Financial Services Disaster Assistance phone number, which is 1-800-22-STORM or 850-413-3089. And I'd also like to share the State of Florida Emergency Information Hotline, which is 1-800-342-3557. Also, since this is my first time coming to Taylor County, I only began this past fall. I like to share one of the most fun aspects of my office, which is the Division of Unclaimed Property. There's many people that don't know what unclaimed property is. It's simply if you are owed money and a business was not able to return that money to you, it is sent to the state and held onto you forever, and you are able to claim it forever. The website for that is fltreasurehunt.gov. I was actually in Flagler County this morning, which is another county in my territory, and the chair of the Board of Commissioners there had found several thousand dollars for himself, both in his personal and his business account. We encourage you to look under your own name, your family member's name, deceased family member's name, businesses, and the like, and there's billions of dollars in the state funds that people just really don't know is there. So I encourage you guys to all search for yourselves. It's 1 in 5 Floridians. There's 5 commissioners, so statistically, one of you should have unclaimed property that you're not aware of. So if there's any questions, then I look forward to working with you guys and your county in the future.
Good, good. I sure appreciate that.
Yeah.
I'm just telling somebody, it's 12 or more, so it should be. Two of us should have some money. A little average, you know?
Is that money there forever? It doesn't go away.
It is there forever. It never goes away. And we actually just 2 weeks ago, I believe, we do have safety deposit boxes can get turned over to us. Our vault in Tallahassee was built up, and so we had an auction. And if you found out that, you know, you had a safety deposit box you had forgotten about, or a deceased family member, you know, grandfather or grandmother or something like that, if it was sold during the auction, then the face value of what it was sold for will get returned to you through the website. And the website is very easy to navigate. Again, fltreasurehunt.gov. You'll search for your name or your business or what have you. I also encourage, if you go by a nickname, there's several people who have searched their first name, however, they're juniors and they go by their middle name. You search under their middle name and it's been there instead. So you go to the website, you search your name, it'll come up with an address. If the address is either your current one or one from the past, I found one for a family friend was his first apartment when he moved here in the 70s. So again, it stays forever. but if it matches your name and the address is when you currently hold in the past, you can go in and you'll put in either your social security number or for a business an EIN. If it's approved, meaning, you know, it is your account, because, you know, if your name is Jenny Smith, there's going to be many of them. So it'll match you up, you go through a few more things, and then it will go to the state. A few months later, you'll get a check in the mail for your, you know, $30, $300, $3,000. Safe Up Patronus himself did a phone drive for it one time, picked up the phone, did 10 calls, and the 10th call found a woman who had $40,000 owed to her by a deceased husband. So again, some of the amounts are nominal, some of them are very large.
Is this an interest-bearing account? And if so, does the interest go to the person that the money belongs to, or is this something that the state of Florida can keep?
So what happens is that when money is turned over by a business, it goes to actually fund education. There's no interest, it's the face value. You know, if it's $30 from the 70s, it's going to be $30 today, unfortunately. But the money is basically continually cycling through. As you pull money out, somebody else is not realizing that they have a refund due to them. One I found a lot of is cable companies. You'll return, you get your cable for a few years, you move, you return the box. Well, you're owed money back when you return the box, and nobody thinks about it, and now you've moved, so you don't have an address. So a lot of them are smaller things like that. Obviously, with the C-stamp numbers and things, with things that, you know, were not known to the family or the lawyers or what have you. There's lots of different ways that people can lose their money, and it ends up in this account. So.
Actually, our office, if we issue checks to someone on the board's behalf, on the clerk's behalf, and they never cash it and never claim it, we send that money once a year to unclaimed properties with who's, you know, with their name and address and who's
there. I think I've got some of them. Mm-hmm.
We're gonna get hold of you. If this is like we don't know how to get hold of, never claimed it, we said once a year we do that.
Yes. So again, that's exactly. There's a lot that will just simply say cashier's check. Not really sure where it comes, especially the later ones where the documents weren't as good, especially if they were, you know, paper files. More recent ones are going to be more electronic, so it's easier to track down where exactly it came from. But it's there. If it's yours, it's there.
Yeah. You know, I have another question. You know, every now and then, like if you belong to Sam's or Costco Club, you'll get a check for $60, $70, $130, something, whatever. And there was one time that I forgot I had that check and it expired. Now, is something like that, is it turned in? Or is it just gone?
In that particular scenario, I'm not sure. But do you know that if a business owes you money, they cannot keep it. I would imagine that it would likely be turned over to that. FLtreasurehunt.gov. Hopefully we can change it.
Thank you. Tonight.
I do. So if you have any more questions about that, I believe all of you have my business card. Mm-hmm. So you have my business card. Feel free to reach out to me personally. Again, there's numbers through the state, but if there's anything that you're not really sure who to reach out to, even if it's not directly under my department, I still obviously have good connections and a better understanding of who exactly to refer things to. And I work really closely with the governor's regional as well. I'm not sure if our regions are a little bit divided up differently, but I'm more than happy to help get you to who you need to be with.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Have a safe trip home.
Thank you.
That was interesting.
Order number 15. Constitution officer, other governmental units, the board, to consider approval of the sheriff's budget amendment request. As an agenda by Mark Thompson, under sheriff.
Yes, sir. It's the same as we've done each time. We've asked y'all for a budget amendment for funds that we've paid out, like in the for boat ramps and stuff like that. That's not budgeted items. Mm-hmm. There is one item in there, however, that was from last year's budget, and that's that 40-something thousand government from the COVID grant. Mm-hmm. So the caveat is, we'd like to keep that money to give you another inmate work group. And I think Ms. LaWanda has an amendment to our contract to talk about tonight for that very reason.
So this would be for the remainder of the fiscal year.
Remainder of the fiscal year.
Yes. Part of the money would be utilized for, which equals about $27,000 or something like
that. Yeah, well, maybe a little more.
So May, June, July, August, and September.
Yes.
And then you had, and then the balance of that was for comp time.
Yeah, and we've had it for like the traffic grant that we pay out the overtime for, and then we're reimbursed by the state. So it comes out of our funds up front, and then we're reimbursed by them. We're just asking to be able to keep that money.
What cost of that
new squad, was it $60,000?
It's $65,000 a year, but they are agreeing to provide a squad for the remainder of the fiscal year, asking to keep part of these funds for that. And then if this agreement continues for next fiscal year,
budgeted in the budget.
It would be budgeted as an additional expenditure.
Okay, so the difference then, and I'm looking at item, agenda item number 22. The board to consider approval of amendment to the sheriff's inmate work squad agreement. And when I read that, you know, it was to provide the additional work squad. Do we need to tie that, Mr. Chair, do we need to tie that into this agenda item or not?
Do we? The one?
I would say that this item needs to be considered first.
Okay.
And then if this is approved because of the language in the amendment, then next, you could approve the amendment to the work squad agreement if you wish.
Okay, and maybe we will move that down, move number 22 up.
If you like.
I mean, if Marty's here, I mean, if there's any questions or
Okay, all right, let's do that. Do you want to go ahead and approve number 15?
I'd like to approve number 15.
Second.
Motion second, all in favor?
Aye.
All right, then let's move number 22 up to that, the board to consider approval of amendment to sheriff inmate work squad agreement, presented by the county administrator.
As you know, we are somewhat short due to the losing our DOC inmate work squad.
Mm-hmm.
The sheriff's office has agreed to provide us an additional work squad. And so Conrad prepared this amendment to the agreement for us. The terms is no money exchanging hands, basically. They would use their amendment funds to furnish the squad for the remainder of the fiscal year.
Make a motion to approve the amendment to the sheriff's inmate work squad agreement.
Look at it. Motion second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Can you start tomorrow?
Yeah, we should.
So, yeah. We
have identified the person that we're going to use for the outside work squad. We just got to identify some inmates now for you. So let's try Monday for a start date.
They have plenty of inmates.
You do. But not plenty that can come out.
All right.
All right. Thank y'all.
All right. We go to number 16. Board to consider reappointment of one member to the Taylor County Development Authority, TCDA board, as agenda by the county administrator.
Make a motion to reappoint John Hart to the TCDA board.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Right. Thank you. You did great. Number 17, the board to discuss golf cart ordinance. Okay.
This is now, Mr. Chairman, we discussed back in the workshop, and I think we decided to instruct or request Mr. Bishop to amend that to allow for the Keaton Beach area to be able to rent golf carts. Right. If I have my motion, I will make it in that form.
All right.
I'll second it.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye. So the question is, you want to amend the golf cart ordinance to include the entire Keaton Beach area? Is that what we're still doing here?
Yes, sir.
Okay. We're not talking about rentals. We're talking about just include. Are we talking about rentals or are we talking about?
As I understand, this includes in the original ordinance, it would be rentals.
Rentals?
Yes, sir.
Lock someone to go down there and rent those golf carts. Okay.
Okay, so I just want to make sure that I'm understanding this correctly, that it was just an amendment to our golf cart ordinance to include rentals in Keaton Beach.
Keaton Beach area, yes, sir.
Keaton Beach. Okay.
Yes. Now, do we need to make another motion?
Clerk?
The one, sufficient?
Yes, we got it.
Okay.
Can I ask a question?
Go ahead, yeah.
Did you have a chance to discuss the flashing speed limit signs or anything like that that we discussed at the workshop?
I have.
In terms of the cost of that and?
No, I have not, but I will. So can you remind me where, your idea of where they actually needed to go? Do we want additional signage in a specific area?
Well, I mean, is that what the board, we talked, I just want to make sure the board's.
We talked about having a sign that would tell you what speed you're going when you come in to keep the.
Oh, I understand. Okay, so I believe the sheriff's office actually has that. Yes, thank you. That trailer that advises folks at whatever speed they're traveling. Now, I don't know that that's a permanent trailer, so.
I don't think that that's what we had in mind. I think we had in mind more of a permanent structure, like it's on Connor Boulevard and Lynn County.
Outside of Connor.
Okay.
It's always there, and it always is giving you your speed limit. If you're going too fast, it'll change and slow down.
Yeah, and I'll tell you something else. It doesn't work all the time. When you see it, you see the sign before you see the speed. And after you, as you get closer, then it will come on, illuminate.
Right.
Yeah, it looks like to me you're gonna need a couple of those down there. I mean, I could just see somebody running too fast and not recognizing this. And
they do go very fast. Could we put that on the next agenda, please? Yes. If you think you'll have time between now and then?
If I don't, then I should be ready by the first meeting in June. I just have to locate that particular type of signage and see what would be involved.
Okay, and I think we need to also have communication with the sheriff and see if he, you know, if he'll help us, and he's been good about it before, help us with that speed limit in that beach area. And it's day and night, I'm telling you.
That sign you're talking about, is it solar power?
I was thinking it might be solar. It might not be, but I was thinking it might be.
That'd be good if they were.
They probably can make them solar, right? That's come a long way, you know, all that.
Isn't a lot of FDOT stuff solar?
Yeah, I mean, it's solar panels on a lot of things now, on major highways, you know.
Yeah.
But right there, if we have one like you see when you cut through a Tallahassee around to the loop, that really gets people's attention. I was watching a truck up ahead of him. Soon as he got close, I'm blinking. I seen his brake lights come on. Everybody, they pay attention to them signs like that, you know. Tell them if they're going 50 or 40 or whatever, you know.
You know, sometimes people are speeding because they speed. But sometimes, you know, you might really be thinking about it. And when you see that sign, you automatically look at your speed. I do.
Yeah, these cars will go faster than you think. They're so quiet and all now, you just don't think you're going in a hurry, you know. You don't know it's not true.
Keep people mindful of the law.
Okay. We go to number 18, the board to consider approval request to rename the Fire Station 7 and the memory of Chad Reed as agended by Commissioner Newman.
Mr. Chairman, this is another item we spoke about in the workshop. And as we stated in that meeting, our REIT family is in support of renaming Fire Station 7 in honor of Chad for his service. So this would be able to recognize his service and honor him and his family. So with that, I would make a motion to rename Station 7 in honor of Mr. Chad Reed.
Do we have anybody that's called in? Can you check?
I just checked on that. We have no callers.
Okay, and the reason that I asked that is I had several calls since the last meeting of people that feel like that the fire station should be saved to be named after the firefighter Williams. Now, I want to go ahead and publicly state as a mother who's lost a child, I know how the Reed family feels, and I know how the Williams family feels. And if you're Mrs. Reed, and if somebody indicated that maybe they didn't want to honor your son, it would be a very hurtful thing. But on the other hand, if you're Mrs. Williams, you would feel the same way. So I personally am not going to give an opinion on this fire station because it's a very sensitive, and I understand the sensitivity that goes with it. I'm only the messenger.
I'm not the chairman.
I want that clear, that I'm only the messenger, but I did have several calls, and they said they were going to call in tonight. But being such a sensitive situation, but they said that, you know, that this, that Mr. Reed had been memorialized in a big way, and that and you know, you know what, Pat, goes from there. And I'm not making a judgment on that at all.
Sure, Mr. Chairman, I believe we can address that, and as I stated in the workshop, and I have spoken with the Williams family, and I've spoken with several folks that voice concerns about Mr. Reed's talking about. So in the midst of that, we had had discussions, and you know, this wasn't, I guess, an effort that, you know, we wanted to upset any residents, yeah, or any family, of course. But you know, in discussions with the Williams family, and speaking with the staff, and we've worked on several of these items, they have agreed, if the board would move a later time to rename Station 1 in honor of Dave Williams. And the folks that I spoke to in respect of that, were open to do that. Station 1 being the station that Mr. Williams served out of. So it was the house that he actually served in here in town. So, again, I understand folks respectfully approaching and addressing this issue is certainly sensitive, and you know, we don't want to dishonor anybody's memory or service. So, again, if there's more discussion, I'd be glad to address that. But I did have the opportunity, because the Williams family did reach out to me personally, and so we had some conversations, and they are open to that at the appropriate time, is where we left that. But they also requested that we wait until a later time, not to see that. And which I'm in full support of honoring their wishes. But
yeah, it's obviously one of them situations that no parent who, like you, never won't have to endure, you know, lose a child. You know, I mean, I couldn't imagine. I hadn't been there, but I couldn't imagine. And my heart goes out to the family, you know, for sure. I don't know them personally, you know, but I've heard nothing but, you know, good things about the trees, you know, the family. You know, I've heard nothing but good things about these guys. You know, like Mr. Commissioner Fiegel, I've had, you know, numerous calls in regards to, you know, same as what we talked about, no disrespect to, you know, this family. You know, I think they have done a great job in honoring Mr. Reed with a, you know, major bridge, and you know, along with the highway. I think there's a sign along the highway. And I would be more in favor of, you know, instead of naming the fire station, I'd be more in favor of maybe a, like a memorial brick type deal. Know, in this particular situation. Like I said, I know the family, that I don't know them at all. You know, I just, once you get the name and a bunch of different, several different items, it's just about what you do for one, you may have to do for all. And you know, I just, maybe a memorial brick would be more feasible than, you know, the whole station itself. But I'm open to what
I have.
And I've talked to the, you know, the Williams family as well, the same as, you know, what Mr. Newman had mentioned about, they are good with, you know, moving this out another month and Station One being named after Mr. David Williams. I mean, this wasn't the meeting to do it, you know, just, you know, you want it to be real heartfelt for my family and what their dad went through, and so, you know, this meeting wasn't really the one for that. So they are, just like Commissioner Newman said, they are.
I kind of thought in the workshop we talked about naming the fire station at the airport.
David Williams.
Just Williams. No, that was my.
That's true.
And that's what they're saying.
Yeah.
But don't do it tonight.
Don't do it tonight, but that's what I would love to see done. I'm friends with the family. My wife taught Little Reg at school, and she taught the world of it. You know, and that's just, and she taught a lot about him when he got killed. And that'd be fine. I'm fine with that.
Okay.
What y'all saying is we go ahead and name the fire station in St. Hatchie after Mr. Reed. And then turn around in another month or so, give Mr. Williams.
And do process it, do wrong.
I'm fine with it.
All right. So I've got a motion. You made a motion.
I'll second.
Okay, you got a motion, second, all in favor. Okay. All ready? We go to county items, staff items. Board to consider approval of the Florida Department of Transportation transfer and maintenance agreement for the Osceola Bridge. Replacement project adoption and authorizing resolution as adjusted by the county engineer.
I'm gonna read the resolution by title only.
Got a motion?
Second.
Motion second. Title on. Bishop?
Got a vote on.
Got a vote on? Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
You ready for me to read the title?
Yes.
I hope I'm reading the right title. The resolution of the Board of County Commissioners of Taylor County, Florida, endorsing delivery of a project for bridge number 544092 at CR 14 over Osceola River by the Florida Department of Transportation in Taylor County, Florida. Did I get the right one?
Yes, sir.
Good.
Okay, Mark. Okay, so what this is DOT through the bridge replacement program is coming around to replacing the bridge at some of those that know locally, it's like Walker Springs Bridge, down on County Road 257A. And like all other bridges that cross rivers at county boundaries, they are typically a responsibility of one entity or the other. This one happens to be under the jurisdiction of Jefferson County for overall maintenance. But because there are portions of it beyond the abutment that extend down into Taylor County, that's why you have a three-party agreement, that being DOT, Jefferson County, and Taylor County. And through this agreement, just like anything else, because of federal bridge replacement funds, there's a responsibility for the structure to be owned by DOT during the construction period. And then once that's finished, then they revert that ownership back to the local jurisdictions. That's what's embodied in this agreement, and you will see that the delineation of responsibility for maintenance going forward is consistent with the way that is today. Some of the comments that you saw attached from the county attorney in there, specifically like utilities and things like that and responsibilities of the county, that's typically when you get into the maintenance aspect of it once it's already constructed. That's when, if we were to do anything, we would be responsible for those facets of it based on our responsibility to maintain it just the way we have today.
Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
First comment, did you agree with this agreement? I read your letter.
I didn't disagree, but I wanted to make everybody clear on some of the issues involved in it. That's why I wrote the letter instead of doing it orally. It's a three-party agreement, and they're passing things on to us. and to Jefferson County. And we've got to ensure that his property is free of encroachments, and if we fail to maintain and repair, and FDOT has to do it, the county has to pay FDOT back at its sole discretion. Sole discretion. That's important, in my view. The other thing is that we'll indemnify FDOT to the limits of 768-28, which is a statute. One of the funny things I thought was, here we've got a bridge that's going over Jefferson County and Taylor County, and venue's going to be in Leon County of any dispute. Did y'all see that?
And we have to do that
as because they won't do it unless we sign it, but it just seems kind of silly to me. And I hope they know that I said it was silly. But I don't have any objection to it. I just wanted everybody to be aware of some of the things that may befall it later on. In other words, once it's built, it's y'all's, so to speak.
It is, and like I said, it's no different than the bridge that you guys were just speaking about that crosses the Steinhatchee River. It has to be assigned an ownership for one county or the other. That one happens to be Taylor County, but it extends over into Dixie. So Dixie has a similar role on that bridge that we have on this bridge. And if you were to take the time to look at Section 9 of the agreement, you would see that DOT was pretty specific on the aspects that Jefferson County would continue to be responsible for relative to what Taylor County would be responsible for. So this doesn't put any additional hardship on us. It's a means for us to go through at no cost or no expense to local tax dollars and to replace our aging infrastructure. So we look at it as it's kind of a necessary evil for us to be able to transfer this out, allow the project to happen, and then our maintenance picks up just like it did before the bridge was ever replaced.
Okay.
You know, and I read this very carefully since it's in my district. And, you know, it says Jefferson County was responsible for the maintenance and repair of the new bridge. Then it says no cost to Taylor County, but states under the terms of the agreement, Taylor County shall be only responsible for construction costs associated with that portion of the project located within its jurisdiction boundary that's ineligible for federal funds.
Yes, ma'am. And I picked up on that, and I did send questions out to the project administrator who was pushing this agreement to us or forwarding it to us to ensure that we were not going to have any responsibility based on this project. And it would only be in those instances where we elected to request a facet or a component of the project that was beyond the terms of eligibility under the Federal Bridge Replacement Program. Let's say we wanted all of our rail in Taylor County to be painted, associated with the bridge, to be painted pink. All right, they're not going to do that. So if you want to paint pink, you're going to pay to paint it pink. And that's just something that we realize. You know, we do a design review when they go through these projects. They forward it up to me. They forward it up to Hank. We look through it. We give our input to it. We critique it just like they critique our jobs. Realizing that if we go in there and we say we want something different, like we want the side ditches concrete versus a granite riprap material to control the erosion, that increase in scope would be our cost responsibility. But if we leave it consistent with the state and the federal standards, but we just look at, you know, maybe width, length, things like that, that cost is covered. I do this on every bridge that gets replaced in this county, that I go through and review these things with the designers, and we provide our input. They make some changes, they don't make some changes, but there's never been an instance yet, not to say that there wouldn't be, but we know very well that we can't go beyond the eligibility scope, or else that's a cost that we have to bear.
Yeah, well, if you recall, and I know you do, a couple or three or four years ago, whatever it was, and there were structural problems with this bridge. This is the one they called Walker Bridge at one time.
Walker Springs.
And if you recall, when we talked with Jefferson County at large, you know, and they wanted us to help pay for those repairs. And we said, no, that's not for us to do. That's your problem.
That's correct. And that's the right posture. Because they are, that, you know, Jefferson County is in the position to receive that funding in order to replace that infrastructure. Just like we are in that same position for the Dixie County Bridge. So it's not necessary nor appropriate for a different jurisdiction to have a funding liability beyond the line of demarcation that's in this plan, that's in this agreement.
And do you, when you look at number 9, does it clearly state that Taylor County does not have any maintenance or repair responsibility?
If you look at section 9, you'll see where that line of jurisdiction picks up at. And I think it says on the south approach or south abutment, mm-hmm. from that point beyond southward into Taylor County, everything from that approach back towards the north, which is inclusive of the bridge and all the components, is Jefferson's responsibility. That's why in my agenda item, you'll see that I specifically cited section 9 and tried to identify to you guys, these are the parts that DOT is being very obvious to say it's going to continue to be Jefferson's responsibility and not Taylor's.
I'm glad they've defined that like that.
Me too, or else I would have asked for it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay,
we have the resolution. So I'll make a motion to adopt the resolution.
Okay. Motion and second. All in favor?
Aye. I'll make a motion to approve the transfer maintenance agreement.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
All right, you got another?
Yes, sir.
Number 20. The board to consider the approval of the Florida Department of Transportation FDOT construction and maintenance agreement for district wide school zones improvements and adoption of authorities. Authorizing resolution is agenda by the county engineer.
Motion to read the resolution by title only.
Second.
Motion and second, read by title only. All in favor? Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. The resolution of the Board of County Commissioners of Taylor County, Florida, which authorizes the chairperson to execute a construction and maintenance agreement for the Taylor County School Zone signage and marketing upgrades. Is that the one?
Yes, sir.
That's the title.
Yes. And that's pretty much consistent with all these agreements. They are basically just wanting to make sure that the body as a whole is endorsing the chairman to sign it on behalf of the board.
This is a good deal for us, too.
It is. When we did the Pinecrest project, we were aware of this happening and coming down the road. So what we did as part of our project, we did update the signage that was through there, but we only relocated the beacons. So what you're going to see in this job is that they're going to come through and upgrade those beacons to your LED high intensity lighting and better sign plaques. And what you're also seeing is this is the second or third version of the agreement, because the first one that they sent to me had all the school zones up in the town area here. And I told them, I said, look, you need to change this because we're not going to be responsible for those signs and facilities that are within the city's operated right of way. Because as soon as I sign this, then I'm accepting that.
Mm-hmm.
They're like, no, it's you maintain those signs. Like, I'm telling you, no, I'm not. You know, you're going to change this. And then ultimately they did. They said they needed to update their records. So what you saw for like 3 or 4 schools got whittled down to just one school. All of them are still getting done, but it's not going to be our responsibility to maintain those going forward.
Good looking out. I said good looking out.
Yes, sir.
All right.
I make a motion to adopt the resolution and also to accept the maintenance agreement.
Second.
Motion in second, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye, okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Appreciate it.
Number 21, the board to consider approval of the Florida Commission for Transportation Disadvantage Planning Grant Application. Form and application of authorized resolution. For the upcoming fiscal year 2021-22, grant cycle is agended by Jamie Evans, the grant coordinator.
Motion to read the resolution by title only.
Motion second, read by title only, Mr. Bishop.
I'll read the first paragraph. A resolution of the Taylor County Board of County Commissioners here and after the board hereby authorize the filing and execution of a transportation disadvantage planning grant agreement with the Florida Commission for the Transportation Disadvantaged.
So, Lonnie, you got something to say there?
Just if you have any questions, this is a standard grant agreement that we enter into every year that we use to fund part of the grant coordinator's salary.
Okay.
Motion to adopt the resolution.
Second.
Motion in second, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Okay, we've done 22, so for 23, the board to consider approval of the draft driver's license CDL policy is agended by the county administrator.
This is a request for the board to consider amending our policies to allow employees who reside in Georgia who wish to work for the board to hold their driver's license and their CDL license in Georgia. It just simply helps with our labor pool.
Yeah.
And we, you know, obviously need CDL drivers, so we would like to be able to extend this.
And this is an acceptable practice, I read.
Yes, ma'am. We did check with our carrier. Actually, we checked with our auto insurance carrier, and they stated that if we did not amend our policy and we had an employee who held a CDL license from another state, that they may not honor that policy. So we knew we needed to make this change. We also reached out to Krisner to get their opinion, and they agreed that this was perfectly acceptable.
We need to do this.
I'll make a motion to approve.
I'll second.
Motion second, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right, 24, the county administrator discuss operations.
The sheriff's office has been a great source of assistance with county upkeep as we obviously have lost our DOC squads, and we are very grateful for their help. We have been able to keep up with mowing and cleaning. We have a schedule in place, and having this additional squad will be a great help. We've advertised the janitorial position. Unfortunately, we have still not received any applications for any of our open positions besides concession stand workers. So I have reached out to workforce and asked them to assist us, and we plan on having a job fair later this month, hoping that that would generate some applications. But for now, we're really just trying to do the best we can with upkeep of cleaning our restrooms, mowing, keeping up the sports complex. Mr. Mullins has taken on some additional duties. He's doing all of the striping or the lining of the fields, cleaning the restrooms. We've all just had to really band together. Our special projects manager has been doing a lot of mowing. And so we're really just continuing to try to keep up with everything on a weekly basis, and I'm very grateful for everyone who's helped with this.
I was speaking to a group of people today, and I mentioned that, you know, we were having difficulty in recruiting people, and it just so happened that, you know, I had the lady, when I was talking about mosquito truck driver, mm-hmm. She needs a job, but I told her some of the jobs available, and she said her son may be interested in the job at Hodges Park, but, you know, I sent you all that information, and hopefully, you know,
great.
Hopefully it'll work out, you know.
Well, for right now, our plan is if we do not have additional employees, we will depend on our current labor force. They may incur some overtime. That's not unusual during the seasonal months. Sometimes we do have to reach out to our regular staff to help with some of these jobs, but we'll see what happens.
Well, we need those drivers because I'm getting calls from mosquitoes and I'm telling you they're out.
Well, we started spraying last week. We have asked the state to help us with collecting data. Now, from what I heard today, mosquito control has not received a whole lot of calls. But so we need to encourage people to call.
I do. I tell them, call.
Is there an age limit on being able to run that truck?
Sir?
Is there an age limit on being able to run that truck?
You have to be at least 18.
Well, that's what I mean. That's a legal adult, for sure.
Yeah. So that's really all I have as far as operational updates.
Okay.
Do you want to move to informational items?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Could you, just like you have in the past, could you send us a schedule for the spraying?
I did ask for that, yes.
Yeah.
So I'll send them.
And when they know, when people call us, because they yell, they're going to be in your area and, you know.
I did ask for that. I spoke with Mr. Womble today and asked him to make sure they start sending us a schedule.
And I'd like to know where they sprayed last week too, if you can get that information also. Thank you.
Just for the board's information, our legislative appropriation request, we submitted 3 projects. The project for Forest Capitol Hall improvements made it within the budget. We still have to wait for the governor's approval, but the total that was in the budget was $81,675, and that's for electrical, sound, and lighting upgrades. And this will hopefully encourage increased and larger event activities. So once the governor finishes his process, then we'll know if it actually will go forward.
The paving out there, what's the plan for that?
So we will need to work on a scope of work. We will try to get that done as soon as we can, and then we will start. We'll either have to put it out for bid or go through the quote process.
Yeah, I want to talk to you more in detail about the handicap arena area. Yes. We discussed that before, but it needs to be expanded.
Yes,
and there's some issues there. I'll get with you on that later.
Okay. I know we did move a sign to make sure that was clearly identified, but...
As a matter of fact, you and I maybe... When you have time and I have time, let's just ride out there.
Sure. And that's all I have.
That's all you have? Okay. Thank you. I'm asking and concerned from the public on non-agenda items. Is there anyone?
No.
Okay. Then you go to board information items. Mr. Newman?
Good.
Ms. Fiegel?
Yeah, I got some doozies tonight.
Go ahead.
The first one, can a mosquito truck driver or any other county employee, can they carry a concealed weapon if they have a permit? I was asked that today and I did not know. You'll check on it? Okay.
Goodness gracious.
Here's another one.
Okay.
I had someone to call me today that lives on a private road. And she wants to know, I know the answer, but I told her I'd ask. She wants to know if we can put a speed limit sign at the beginning of that private road.
I don't believe so.
Mm-hmm.
I don't believe so.
I've asked. Thank you. Also, this lady called and she has a situation with her brother-in-law. And her brother-in-law built a house on her property And I guess that was before her husband passed away, and it happened. And now her husband is deceased, and the brother-in-law that lives on the property that does not have a deed to the property, she says, has placed a 2,000 square foot shed on the property 8 years ago. Now she wants it gone. She says that she's been paying the taxes on it for 7 years, and then last year they paid the taxes, and she said she went to the property appraiser, and the property appraiser had went out or had put a value on that property, but yet she's really mad at the county because there was no permit or inspection. And so I told her I would ask about it. So she wants the shed gone. She wants to know what to do. And she's mad because there was not a permit and an inspection.
With regard to her problem, she needs to see an attorney. It's a civil matter for her own.
I told her exactly what Conrad told me.
You know who I'm talking about?
Yes.
Okay.
Sorry, but we're not a panacea, you know. Can't solve every problem for people.
And then in terms of a permit and inspection, I mean,
supposed to request that. You're supposed to come to the county offices to get the permit. I mean, it's on the citizen to do that as a practical matter.
That's all I have, thank you. I told you that we didn't say so.
Yeah.
I'd like to say, I brought up a question about the dishes and the culverts out there on East Ellison out there the other day. And after doing some research on the drawings that were sent to the landowners and what all was said, our engineer did his due diligence. He set a date, like they do on all roads, or somebody got any questions about what's going to take place on the road. They have a date that they can come to the meeting, sit down and look at the drawings, and they actually get drawings sent to them. Our engineer did his due diligence. I researched all that, and I'm fine with what he did. I'm glad he does that. And, you know, the dishes there were put there for a reason, you know, and the people did not have access into their property. It's wooded, the whole block's wooded, you know. And if they had, you know, went to that meeting and looked at that drawing, seen there was going to be a ditch there, they'd have had time to put some access in there before the job ever started, you know, and then they'd have had a leg to stand on. But the way it is, they don't have a leg to stand on to get the county to put them a culvert in. So our engineer, he did his job, and I'm proud he did, and I researched all that, and I'm fine with that. But from here on out, when I ever get another road done in my area, I'm going to do some research myself to make sure that the constituents up down that road know to go to that meeting or don't ask any questions later on about it. You know, that's just something everybody needs to follow along and kind of keep people in their district. You know, when you get a new road done, make sure everybody's on the same page.
They just probably needed to make sure some of that was in writing versus a verbal.
Right, well.
Some of that wasn't in writing, and I think that maybe somebody said it, and everybody got amnesia when it come down
right to
it, so they probably just need to make sure they get it in writing.
Well, if somebody looked at the drawing and didn't understand what, you know, a lot of people wouldn't look at them drawing and understand what that dish even looked like on the drawing. But once I saw the dish on the drawing that they could have come to the meeting and looked at, and they actually got a copy of the drawing sent to it, you know, all the landowners along the road. Jay's planning on the safe. I mean, it's just a thing that can save you some issues down the road, what I'm saying. Just to research that.
If I may, now, if we have a road such as that, and you got one person that disagrees, say, okay, I'm not agreeing to this, but all of the other people on the road agree, what would happen? Is this like a majority situation, or can one person stop that road because they don't like the ditch, or what? How do we do that?
Well, I would say that if we need that person to sign the hold harmless, and we need to document where the right of way is, then it's possible that that could hurt the project.
But
if we need the hold harmless and the right of way, and someone refuses to agree to that, I think that it could cause an issue. And if I'm not mistaken, you know, in the past, if we've had projects like that, we have had to either change the design, or I can think of one road recently where we just actually backed up where the pavement was going to go because of that particular situation.
Wow. You know, I don't know about that.
I had one of my ditches, that's what happened when they went to do pave Freeman Road. I had one of the landowners would not sign till the county went back and fixed something on their son's property that they left out of the drawing up there, put in a culvert in a place where it was flooding them. It was knee deep at their mailbox. They couldn't even drive to their mailbox. Once we got that situated up in Malcolm's district there, worked through that, then they signed to pay for it and finish back the Freeman Road.
Well, I'm thinking more specifically that, like in this case, when they realize that the ditch is going to be there and how deep it's going to be, that they say, okay, if you're not going to put me in a turnoff, I'm not going to sign this whole harmless. And can that, you know, mess up the whole project? Because that doesn't seem, you know, a lot of people don't understand what we go through to get just the very few roads paved. I mean, not many. And so if you're fortunate enough to be able to have your road paved, then I'd hate for one person to mess that up just because they feel like we should put them in a free driveway when they didn't have one before. So if that's the way it is, we need to address that.
I don't necessarily think that's the case, that one resident could endanger an entire project. I do believe that if we need right of way, that we may have to work around a citizen if they refuse to cooperate. But I can't see just an entire project being endangered because someone doesn't want it there. Because that's the county's responsibility. It's the county's property, and we're responsible to upgrade, you know, our road system and our stormwater conveyance system at the end of the day.
Well, you know, my husband went to pick up food from this person's establishment this weekend, and she hit him up about it and said she would have never signed that had she known that the ditches were going to be the way they were. And, you know, we have a really good engineer, and if he puts his name on something, you can take it to the bank because it's going to be right. He's going to dot every I and cross every T. And so I never had any doubt that he had not gone through that process the way it's supposed to be, because just, you know, working with him for 11 years, I've kind of figured out how he operates.
Oh, absolutely. and that is, you know, he does make sure that our citizens have access to that information. And if they choose not to come to meetings or to ask questions, then that's not his responsibility.
It's not. And you know, there's roads all over Taylor County that have deep ditches. You know, we've got situations like that. My family's got situations like that where, you know, out of ours, we put our own culvert in, of course. On the other side, I, you know, would never expect the county to come in and put me a turnoff there, because number one, when you get a paved road, it increases the value of your property right then. So anyway,
I think a lot of this is just any paving project and is going to be a change. And I do understand if citizens are accustomed to having particular access points to their property, that it is a shock factor, and it takes some getting used to. And I do understand that, but I do think that we try to work with citizens every way we can to facilitate their needs and to understand their particular request and to help them any way we can.
And that's true, because I know that on the Foley Cutoff Road, where you've got people, and they have brought forth documentation that proves that at one time they did have a turnoff.
Correct.
And I think that staff, y'all went above and beyond to try to help these people, you know, so that's a story that's gonna probably have a good ending, because they could establish that they had one at one time. Mm-hmm. Whereas in the other case, we couldn't find anything where there was ever an address or a 911 address or a mailbox or anything.
Correct.
Okay. Anything else to come?
Real quick, the mediation and the root case that Commissioner Moody and I were going to go to was set for June the 3rd, but they didn't let me know that it was going to be set for June the 3rd. We sent them an email to say to change that. And Lawanda, you may have been seeing those emails. Kind of ticked me off a little bit, you know, that they left me out. But anyway, we'll see what happens with regard to that. Secondly, I prepared a letter for the chairperson to sign to send to General Moody, the Attorney General, on the seawalls. Mm-hmm. And I dug and dug and dug and tried to find some things that I could put into it, because like I told you before, they like to see that you've done some research. I don't know what's going to happen with that letter, but it's been done, and I've sent it to Lawanda to look at, and then if she likes it, then we'll give it to you, and you can look at it and decide whether you want to sign it or not. Okay?
I did get a letter. I got a call from somebody in Michigan, and they said that they had someone working on that seawall, and they run them off, so it didn't look like. And they asked for more time if they could, rather than 6 days.
I did speak with her today and explain the process to her.
Well, and the third thing that I wanted to let y'all know about is at the workshop, we were waiting on the last survey, the legal description on Dead Man's Curve. I got that over the weekend. So Kenneth and I are going to work up a letter to each landowner to see if we can't get those properties settled. So we get it done.
I really appreciate that. I got a question though, Comrade, on the Root case, since that's in my district. What did you want?
We're going to find out.
I mean, honestly, what did you want?
Well, I think I'm optimistic that there was some surveyors out there, and I think that those were the insurance people surveyors. And I also suggested to the attorney who's representing the insurance company to have some appraisals done, you know, because whether it increased value or decreased value of property, because I don't think it decreased at all as a practical matter, Jim. And so I think they mellowed on their what they're asking for is I haven't heard any physical physical, you know, money request, except for what we did at the last mediation, which of course is privileged. So to answer your question, like I said to start with, I really don't know, but believe me, you've got Commissioner Moody there. that's right on top of what happened with regard to that, and I don't think we've done anything that was in fact incorrect at all. And this, do you, Tim?
I feel like the county did what they should have done and what everybody agreed on sitting right there in this building. And they got a better road now than they had to start with.
Yeah, there's a lot of, there are people that live there that I spoke to recently that can attest to some of the traffic that's been in and out since this was done, and there's been no problem with any size vehicle all this time.
You got their names?
Sorry?
You got their names?
I sure do.
Okay, good. If we need them, then I'll get touch with them.
I think she'd be very willing to.
Tell us. That'd be great, really, wouldn't it?
It would. They were saying to start with, they couldn't haul the lumber out of their place, but the log truck wouldn't go in there and out, and that kind of thing. Benji Tootin himself brought a log truck up there, and I videoed him backing around the curve with a log truck. So, I mean, there was no issue. So the county of the road never held anybody from doing anything on that road, you know. I think the main thing was, it wasn't done to the speed that he wanted it done, getting everything done. You know, it just drug along a long time, and he was just upset because of the time frame.
And we didn't drag along. This board did not drag at all, but someone.
Right.
Well, if anybody's been up there, if you saw it before and you see it now, so much better now. Big improvement.
Well, we'll let you know what happens.
Do you want to get anything else?
Just a reminder that there is a workshop at 5:00 on Wednesday regarding the DMH Board of Directors.
You know that Cinco de Mayo?
I do. I was reminded of that. I apologize in advance.
It's Cinco de Mayo. So, you know, I've had to tell my children that I have a meeting.
Do I give them up?
Motion to adjourn.